Here you go. Are we ready? Everyone's up.
All right. Good evening, everyone. It is 6:34, the evening of August 21st. This is a regular city council meeting of the Arlington City Council. My name is Rich Nagel. I'm the mayor, and I will be presiding at the meeting. And again, I welcome all of you. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we'll have roll call. Councilmember Hattelstead.
Here.
Councilmember Yashewski.
Here.
Councilmember Batcher.
Here.
Councilmember Call.
Here.
And Councilmember Highland.
Here.
All council members are present. Also present on my left is Interim City Administrator Elvebach. On my right, City Attorney Arneson. We have in our audience EDA Consultant Holly Kreft, Kurt Mink representing the Arlington Enterprise. A few members from the fire department, Mr. Hagenmiller, and I'm sorry, I forgot your name. Yeah.
Curtis Lang.
All right. In the back row?
James Fettig, the Center.
Center Point Energy representative, and Dean Bergerson from the EDA, and also John Zaski representing the fire department. So welcome, everyone. With that out of the way, we would go to item three, approving the agenda. Any agenda items, additions? Hearing none, motion is in order to approve.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
I'll second it.
Motion by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Hattelstead to approve the agenda as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Moving on to the consent agenda. Items in the consent agenda this evening are as follows. Item A, approval of the August 3rd regular meeting minutes. Item B, approval of the August 9th special meeting minutes. Item C, approval of the bills. Item D, approval of optional 2 a.m. closing license for Arlington Dugout LLC. Item E, approval of conditional offer of employment terms for John Pedersen for police chief. Item F, approval of dance permit application for Double Tap Bowling and Sports Bar. And item G, approval of application for exempt permits, Sibley County Agricultural Association. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Yashewski, second by Councilmember Call to approve the consent agenda as is read. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Consent agenda is approved. Motion carried. There are no public hearings tonight. We'll move then on to item number five, addressing the council. Are there any citizens present this evening that wish to address the council at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on to announcements. Item six. Go ahead.
Okay. We have just two announcements at this time. We have the Arlington Farmers Market, which, despite the rain, did go on today and will continue through September in the parking lot. And then a reminder that the city offices will be closed on September 4th for Labor Day. And so that the council meeting that would have been scheduled for Monday night will be moved to Tuesday, September 5th.
Okay, then move right on to communications.
In your packets, you have several different communication items. The first being the water wastewater report from the utilities. We have a police report, which is the monthly and daily logs, which again, a reminder that has been updated on the website, and we will continue to update those. So if individuals want to take a look, We have the monthly financials for July. Again, we're looking very well. There's nothing, no flags or anything that looked out of alignment for this time of the year. And then you have the Sibley County Community Development Newsletter.
Okay, thank you. Any questions in regard to the communications?
Well, it looks like we have more water coming in than going out again.
Always, always. I haven't forgotten about that either and still wonder, and hopefully we're narrowing the gap a little bit, but I think we need to ask that question of people's service next time they have a rep here and see what.
I'll just keep asking.
Just keep asking, mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. We'll move on to then the annual report of the Arlington Economic Development Authority. Holly Kraft, Dean Bergerson.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I am joined this evening by Dr. Bergerson, who is the chair, the president of the EDA. This is my first year as your EDA consultant. I started in January of this year. So you all should have received electronically paper copies, maybe two, of the annual report. Included in that is the goals that we set earlier this year for the EDA, and then a status update on each of those. And then lastly, just some examples of some of the things that we've been working on, so an update to all of the available property listings, so we have a consistent look and theme that ties into our city logo, and then succession planning resources that were mailed out to the local businesses. So with that, I'll take any questions, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Bergerson if he has anything to add.
No, nothing to add. Printout tells it all. We meet about 8 times a year, 8 to 10, depending on how much is going on. And we usually have quorum so we can vote on items that come up. We haven't come across any problems that I can think of.
How long has the price been $175 on the TSE building?
That's what the city had set originally for that price. And usually when I speak with any interested parties, I let them know it's negotiable based on job creation and some of the things that they would bring to the community.
And have we had a lot of interest? I'm sorry.
We have one very interested party, but unfortunately he needs to sign a contract for the sale of his current building in order to more actively pursue the purchase. So.
Do you think a realtor would help if we would?
That's something that we've discussed with the EDA, and I think that's something that we should look at this fall if we don't have, if that option doesn't move forward with the interest.
I just noticed one other thing on here. There's a typo under the business visit.
Mm-hmm.
We'll conduct at least business visit. There was
three. I'm sorry.
Three. Okay. And those are.
Those are need to be scheduled.
Okay.
We did send flyers out. At least I think we did. Current businesses to see what's going to happen as they age and what are they going to do. Sell, pass it on, be alive.
And how we can help them with that process.
I know at a recent EDA meeting there was a discussion and decision to go forward with a grant application, I believe it is, from the Southern Minnesota Initiative Fund. Could you explain that to the other council members, what that involves and what,
sure.
What it's aimed at?
And that falls under the goals specifically for the Sunstone property, the former Sunstone property in downtown. That was both an EDA goal and one of the mayor's goals. And that's to brainstorm uses for that property. So the application is due August 31st. And it would be to pull in together stakeholders, adjacent property owners, Chamber of Commerce, the school district, to see what we can come up with for that property. And
could we find out if we receive?
That would be in October.
October, so it's fairly quick.
How is that dealt with if we receive the grant and we come up with some potential ideas? It really is helping, maybe, potentially would help with the sale of the property.
That would be the intent, is to kind of help
right.
move that along.
How does the, how do we deal with the current owner, Semstone,
mm-hmm.
and their realtor? Because we've actually assisted in making that sale. Is that something that is taken into consideration or not?
That isn't something that we've discussed
okay.
today.
Okay. All right. Any other questions of the EDA representatives? All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate the report.
I was here just so you knew that there was more to EDA than
Then just how
we knew that.
Dean plays a vital role.
Although she is the one.
All right, moving on to item B, the annual report of the Arlington Fire Relief Association. Curtis Lang and Tim Hagemiller.
Thank you, Mary Noggle, for having us here, and distinguished members of the council, staff, here with our annual report, as usual. The SC-17 is generated by our auditor and sent to the state. This is a report that gets sent to the state for anybody that may not know what this report actually is. It's the fire department members and the retired guys, or the guys that are deferred members, it's called, as you'll see in the report, that are no longer active on the department, but they're off the department, and we're on for at least 10 years to pass on for their retirement. I guess I don't know if you got questions. We can go through each one of these. The first page is the active members of the fire department. And if you got any questions while I'm going through it, it's pretty self-explanatory. It has their start dates and what if they were to retire at that accrued liability time, which is this year's time, that's what they would get as a retirement. It could be taken as a lump sum. Or you can leave it in the account and it continues to accrue at a 3% increase. Right, and you can't take it until you're 50. So there's the retirement at this point. You can take it earlier, but there's some
huge penalties.
Right, penalties. The next set of is the retired firefighters. The only one that's on there, Howard Tuchenhagen, is cashed out of his, so that one will be coming off this list. This is actually a year behind kind of list. That's why it's SC-17. It's projected for the next set. It'll have some of the older members on the deferred that may have cashed out already, but that's the only one that I can see on here at this point that's cashed out that will be off from next year, unless more decide to take that option. That's all that the next, what is it, six pages, I think, are. If you have any questions for those individuals, we can definitely cover them. The next set of, the next page, the SC-17, it has the Office of the State Auditor. These are the numbers that active member liabilities, that's what we have to have in our account that if everyone on the fire department wanted to retire today, we have to have them covered. And that's the obligation of the city to make sure that the funds are there other than what our investments get. If our investments fall short of that, then the city has to cover the differences. And you'll see later on that this year it's gonna be a zero amount that the city will have to owe anything for the fire department. Our investments are doing well enough to where they're gaining enough interest. And we have different diversified areas. We have two different brokers that deal with their finances. So it works out pretty good that way. Our investments will go up in one and down in the other and up in one and down in the other, just like everybody else's, I guess. There's some on here too, halfway down, the projected state aid on that same page, just a little bit on that page. The projected state aid, that comes through the insurance that goes from the, everybody that pays insurance for fire or for your homeowner's insurance. There's a certain amount from the state that we get back every year, and that's what it's projected to be for the fire department. That also goes into the relief. It also accrues in for the retirement, so it works out pretty good that way for the state and for us. Everything else is kind of self-explanatory as you go through it on that page. The next page is the Office of the State Auditor. This is what she sees as a final number. The biggest one is the third line down, number 10. Authorization of deficit, that's a zero mark, and that's what the city would have to contribute if there was any that was needed. We've had a couple years back, 2009, and in that time frame when the stock market took a pretty good hit, our investments didn't make it, and that's when some investments had to be made from the city or some funds. The normal, should I say normal? Yeah, I guess I get every year. The way that it works is the city usually donates $100 at least per firefighter on the department if there's a zero amount due. If we could make it towards that again, that'd be awesome because it seems to help out for retirement every year. All this is just straight retirement. We don't see any of this. It goes straight into our special fund until you retire. Other than that, I don't really have any more information that's not on here. And if you got any questions, please bring them forward.
How many active members right now?
26. There's 25 listed on this. Angelica's off of this one at this point. I have to have her added on to it. So it'll change a little bit, but not much for the SC-17. Newer firefighters are pretty low accrued liability at the start. As you see down at the bottom, some of the newest members have been on for, well, it'll be 2 years, and theirs is a pretty low sum, $1,600 at this point. If you were to quit anywhere up to 10 years, if you're 9 years in and you quit, your retirement is no, you don't receive any portion of it. So that's the way it works.
Just curious, what happens to that money? Just curious.
It stays in the account.
Back.
Yep. So that's one thing that also helps in the retirement fund. If they bail out earlier than 10 years, then it actually benefits the city because then the funds are there that would normally be an accrued liability towards them.
Keeps that number 10 number at zero.
Yep, yeah. Exactly. The number 10 number at zero. Yep. And I want to thank the council that's already made the approval for the continuing increases. I think that's made a pretty big difference on some of the senior members on the fire department. I know it has for me. I'm probably going to stick around a couple more years just to take advantage of that. And hopefully we can get some more guys on and train them up.
So this has nothing to do with what the upgrades or whatever we did as far as wages and stuff like that earlier this year?
The wages is nothing.
This is totally separate, or was that part of it?
Part of it.
That was part of it that we agreed to earlier?
Right.
What was that exactly
we agreed to?
We increased the amount.
Right. At the very top
of the
first
page, yep,
where it says to enter the annual benefit level,
yep,
and it says 1300, that increases with what you said. It's,
oh,
I think
that's what it is?
Yeah, that's where it increases.
Okay.
And that increases the accrued liability for everybody because obviously their increase, everybody's will increase as it goes up. This 2018 that's written down there doesn't reflect that until it's approved by the city council. The auditor will look at that number and increase it at that point. They know the audit. They see the minutes from the city council meeting. They wanted to make sure that they had it so that they know what's coming, but they can't put it in here until it's finalized.
So was that not finalized before?
It was by you, but not for the audit.
Okay. I'm just curious here because we have an approval or a denial.
Right, that's to go towards the contribution from the city goes up 3% every year, and so for 2017, you need to actually take action on that to contribute that dollar amount into it. But it's based on the action that was taken previously that it goes up 3% every year.
I guess I'm still confused.
I think that's not right.
No, because it's asking us for
3.5 should
33, 47, and 50 cents. That's on.
It should be.
So what?
It should be based on per firefighter.
Yep.
So that's not correct.
So it should be 2,600.
Yeah.
And you said that's been like past policy or.
Right.
Been
whenever we've had a deficit, it hasn't been put in place. But if we haven't had a deficit, it's been put in place. And it doesn't have to happen, but it usually does.
And you hope it does.
And we hope it does. I'm not trying to talk you out of doing it. That's but that number is higher than what is normal, I guess.
So it should be the 3347 or the 2600?
2600.
I think where she's talking, I saw that someplace in here, though.
That was on our agenda.
Right. I think for my salary, it's supposed to go up as the treasurer. It's supposed to go up. I've never taken an increase since I've been doing it. I think this is my ninth year or eighth year doing it. I've just always left it at 900.
That's
and I've never.
The last page.
It's not that it needs to go up, I don't think.
The last page of what? Now, I'm kind of confused.
Chris, talking about 3% increase under the $900 for 2016.
On the last.
Was 932 again, it's not. It's going to stay at 900.
Second to last page, sorry. Of the whole report. It should be at the top. Calculation of required contribution. Where the $0 was on line 10.
Yeah, with line 10, 0. So one line right above.
Oh, yeah.
That'll stay at 900, not take the 3% or 3.5%.
Right. The auditor, the auditor that we have always puts that in there because it was approved at one time to take the increase every time by the relief, but I've never felt the need to take it. And that's more than ample as far as I'm concerned. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work, but it's not an increase of 3.5%.
There it is. Line 9.
Yeah, line 9.
Right, I see that. I just...
Right.
That with the 2,600, is that what we're... Is that the dollar amount that you're asking for?
I think that 3347 should be 2,600.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Or based on
that would
past?
Right.
Okay.
If you want to put more in there, you're more than welcome.
We'll take it. We're
not going to do that. But the 30, or the 932, that's not on here as well. We're not voting on that.
Because
you're not...
That comes out of the relief's money itself. That's just on the report. That's what the relief pays the treasurer.
Oh, okay. I see where you're going.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's
so it has nothing to do with us?
Nothing to do with you.
Okay.
So what we're looking at doing is amending that approved denial, the dollar amount from 3347.50 to 2600. Is that correct?
Is there 26 or 27 active members with Angelica on there?
26 with Angelica.
26.
With Angelica?
Yep. Because we have, right, John?
It's 26 active.
Yeah, 26 active. The 25 are listed there, and then 26 would be Angelica.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
And so who would have you take extra money to be the auditor? Because I know that it is a lot of work, and I'm just curious. That's up to you, or who's it up to?
It's up to me.
And you just... Thank you.
All right, very much appreciated by the City Council also that you are doing that. All right, any other questions, comments?
We need a motion to approve. I'd make a motion to approve the city's contribution for 2017 for 3,340.
Oh, no, 26.
I'm sorry?
We changed it to 2,600.
2,600.
Even 2,600. $100 per active firefighter.
Oh, okay. $2,600.
Yep. 26.
I'll
okay.
second it.
Motion by Councilmember Hyland, second by Councilmember Hattelstead to approve the contribution for 2017 of $2,600 to the Fire Relief Fund. Any discussion?
If I could. I found where I got that information. I talked to Lisa Tesh to get some information. She said historically that the city has had a zero required municipal contribution to relief, but did voluntarily contribute $100 per member. Then back around 2007, they approved a plan for a 3% annual increase in the per member contribution. Therefore, the city's contribution would simply be the per member amount, which is now up to $128.75 per member. And at the 20, And then dependent upon whether it's 25 or 26 members, you take the 128.275 times the number. So that's Lisa's.
Okay. We just shorted you.
That's where that number came from, just to provide some clarification.
So last year it was well over $100.
Correct. And okay. So this amount that is put here is what was included in the budget.
Okay.
Based on that.
Okay. So the city is bumping it up 3% each year.
Every year. Yep.
Beginning in 07, the way it sounds, probably?
Yes. Yeah. Around 07.
Around 07. Mm-hmm.
That
makes sense. That's
now
why
it makes sense. Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't see that in my reports.
So. Now we're back to the.
Okay, I gotta go back to what I originally said.
Before I interrupted you, right midstream.
We'll take it.
I mean, I was just reading off the chart on the wall.
Okay, the motion then is by Councilmember Hyland, second by Councilmember Hattelstedt, to approve the city contribution for 2017 of $3,347.50. That's based on 26 active firefighting members. And that goes to the Fire Relief Fund. Any discussion? Questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion's carried.
I was just confused.
Thank you for your report.
Contradiction there, and I'm like, what the hell?
Thanks for your report.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
I should have read my cover letter instead of just looking at the pages.
Right. Okay, moving on then to item number 9, ordinances. First reading, ordinance 313.
Well, again, we're in process of gradually moving the ordinance system into a code, and we've presented that in chapter 25, special improvement assessments, chapter 26, streets, alleys, and sidewalks, chapter 27, subdivisions. And I had commented in an email to the council, many cities have subdivision controls within the zoning ordinance, but ours has always been separate. And it is a little bit different issue, a new subdivision, as opposed to zoning rules for existing property. Plus the zoning ordinance, which is going to be one of the last chapters, is way too long already. And so I had commented to the council that I thought it would be good to leave subdivisions in a separate chapter of its own. And then just representing chapters 28 and 29, towers and trees, and all we did there was renumber them. It occurred to me that I had deviated from trying to do this chapter indexing in alphabetical order. Mm-hmm. And so just a matter of moving those back so we retained the alphabetical order. And some of that is, I guess, until I actually finalize the chapter, sometimes I'm debating how to title it. And in fact, I've manipulated a couple of the titles to keep them in alphabetical order. So anyway, again, this is considered a first reading, and I welcome any comments, changes, additions that the council wants to make. And again, also, when we come to the end of the chapters and we're getting close, we would then have a second reading, adopt the code in its entirety, and thereafter, the code is always subject to future change, just as the ordinances were. It's just that the changes should be easier to implement in a code format than they were in the old ordinance format. So, any immediate questions?
And easier comments? To find.
Yes.
Any questions of these five topics for this evening?
How many more chapters are there, Ross?
58. No, I'm just kidding.
Did you see my eyes?
No, actually, as I have it presently indexed, 31.
Okay.
We're at 29. But the zoning chapter, 31, is a very long one. But we're definitely getting towards the end.
Okay.
I would like to see a paper copy handed out to all the council members. before that final reading.
Yes.
That would be nice to be able to really...
Yeah.
Well, and, well, yeah, I mean, it's different looking at it on the screen than it is in your hand, and I think we can be maybe more thorough than at the end. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, we'll consider this then an additional first reading of Ordinance 313. Before we move on to resolutions, I want to make sure that the minutes read that Heidi Jo Fisher is in attendance. So if Corey reads the minutes of the meeting, he knows that she was here. Heidi Jo is a coordinator, volunteer coordinator for the Arlington Night Out, and does a fantastic job. And she is here tonight with us. So with that said, we will move on to resolutions. Resolution 71-2017.
Have a guest here this evening who I think will maybe give a little bit more background into.
Did you want to come up to the mic, please? Introduce yourself.
Thank you, Mayor and the council members. I'm Jim Spedek with CenterPoint Energy. The Community Partnership Grant Program offers an opportunity for CenterPoint Energy to partner with cities we serve. We have partnered with the community supporting our shared commitment to safety while delivering safe, reliable natural gas for over 145 years. Since 2003, the program has exceeded $1.5 million in donations and helped supported the funding of 775 projects in the communities throughout the company's service area. Through our grant program, we are able to help cities leverage local funds to purchase needed safety equipment or support safety projects that are important to your community. I am pleased to present the City of Arlington with a community partnership grant for $2,500 that will be used to purchase a thermal imaging camera. I have that checked with me.
Okay.
So.
All right.
That is it. Thank you.
Do you want any type of...
Did you
photo op?
Kurt,
I'm supposed to be sending photos after this.
Sure.
So.
Bring the check forward, and we'll get it on a picture.
Bring the money. Yeah, that's what we like. All right.
Thank you. I'd like to introduce Resolution 71-2017, accepting a donation and designating its use.
Second.
Okay, Resolution 71-2017 is introduced by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Cowell. And that is a resolution accepting a donation designating its use, and it was accepted from the CenterPoint Energy Corporation in the amount of $2,500 to be used for thermal imaging camera. And is there any questions on the resolution? If not, we'll do by roll call. Councilmember Hattelstead.
Yes.
Councilmember Highland.
Yes.
Councilmember Cowell.
Yes.
Councilmember Batcher.
Yes.
Councilmember Yashevsky.
Yes.
All in favor, none opposed, the resolution is adopted. All right, Resolution 72-2017, and that is on the conditional use permit.
And the council at the last planning, at the joint planning session, heard the background and everything regarding this. So if there are any questions, we would certainly be willing to answer. I believe you have all the information before you.
Council is familiar with this, along with, as City Administrator Elvebach mentioned, this was brought up in discussion at the joint meeting we had with Planning and Zoning, and everything had been mailed out to you in your packet, so it should pretty well lay out what the conditional use permit is based upon, what the request is.
Back up just a little bit, if you would, Laura.
So the recommendations from the planning commission?
There, right there, that's kind of the...
This one?
Yard.
Yep, that one, there we go.
Existing, okay. I drove by there today and it kind of looked, kind of what I envisioned. Existing garage is going to be torn down and the new garage will be put kind of over its footprint and a little more towards the street.
Off the property line. And a little bit forward, right?
Yeah, and looks like, from what I can tell, the pictures, it's going to be pretty much consistent with the neighbor to the east.
To the east, which is his son, by the way.
That's why I didn't see a big fence going down the middle of the driveway there. Good.
And they share the driveway going in to both of their structures. Looks pretty straightforward. It seems like he's very conscious about, you know, doing a good job, making it look like it belongs there, like it is somewhat matching the house.
It sounds like he's using a lot of the local contractors to do the work and everything, too, which is very nice. I'll make a motion to approve 72-2017 conditional use permit for a detached garage at 105 Clinton Street East.
I'll second it.
Resolution 72-2017, introduced by Councilmember Highland, second by Councilmember Hattelstead, and that is to approve the conditional use permit for a 720 square foot detached accessory structure at 105 East Clinton Street. Any comments, questions, discussion?
That is following the Planning Commission recommendations?
Yes.
That's your...
Yeah, they recommended approval.
Right.
I mean, sorry.
With their recommendations? Your motion was with their recommendations?
Including their recommendations, yeah.
Is that correct?
And I think those recommendations are listed on the...
They are listed.
With the resolution, so...
That was my question.
Okay. All right, roll call vote, Councilmember Batchor.
Yes.
Councilmember Hattelstead.
Yes.
Councilmember Yashewski.
Yes.
Councilmember Cowell.
Yes.
Councilmember Highland.
Yes.
All in favor, none opposed, the resolution is adopted. And lastly, in the resolutions, Resolution 73-2017, another donation.
This is...
Numerous donations,
yes.
In fact.
Yep, this just outlines all the donations that were made in regards to the National Night Out.
Right. Let me take just a minute and read these off. I think those that are maybe going to be watching this on TV or whatever should know what kind of support we have for this community-wide. And I'm not going to give the dollar amounts or the items, but just these are the concerns that we're participating in putting a night on. American Legion Post 250, David Luce, donation basket at the event, and German Days, Healing Essence Massage, Jody Schauer, Marge Erickson, Sue Pinsky, VFW Post 6031. Other donations, those were monetary donations. The other donations were Afterburner Auto Body, Amana Federal, Arlington Chamber of Commerce, Arlington House, two of them by Arlington House, Arlington Lions, Good Samaritan Society, Jerry's Home Quality Foods, Kick's Bakery, Lang's Meat Market of Gaylord, Over 60 Band, RSMC, which Ridgeview Sibley Medical Center, and Thomas Brothers. So you can see throughout the community, it is a well-supported endeavor, and we have all those people to thank. We have Patrolman Jordan Voigt to thank, and we have Heidi Jo Fisher to thank for helping put this all together, along with her helpers and everyone that participated. So, very nice job. Would someone wish to introduce a resolution?
I do. I'd like to move that we accept donations that you read off for us.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Whoa, that was a tie.
I'll second.
Makes no difference.
In resolution 73-2017 was introduced by Councilmember Yashewski, second by Councilmember Hattelstead, and that is a resolution accepting donations of $1,715 and in cash, and then prizes, food, and other items for various donors. And I read that list off. Okay, we'll vote by roll call vote. Councilmember Hattelstead.
Yes.
Councilmember Batcher.
Yes.
Councilmember Hyland.
Yes.
Councilmember Cowell.
Yes.
Councilmember Yashewski.
Yes.
All in favor? None opposed? The resolution is adopted. Okay, we'll move on to unfinished business, Johnson Controls update.
At the last meeting, Council kindly authorized me to get references from the League of Cities for attorneys specializing in this type of contract case to possibly refer out to them for analysis as a first step to determine if it's worth bringing a lawsuit against Johnson Controls in regard to our streetlight system problems. The League did provide me with some references. I sent the council an email with results, and based on considerably more experience and a slightly lower quoted hourly rate, my recommendation would be that we refer this to the Pfefferly Kane Law Firm, specifically Steve Pfefferly, to look at our file and give us a recommendation on whether the case is worth taking forward. And the firms that I contacted, including this firm, also indicated they'd be happy to take the litigation if that is the recommendation. And as I noted in the email, interestingly, Attorney Pfefferly indicated that they've sued Johnson Controls before. So I thought that was a plus as well.
So, how did they do in their lawsuit?
Yes.
I should have asked that. Yes. But and both firms estimated, well, they said 4 to 6 hours. I think one said 5 to 6. So I went with a higher figure at 6 hours, and at the Pfefferly Law Firm hourly quoted rate, it's going to be around $1,300 or so, more or less.
For the review.
For the review. And if there's a recommendation either way, I would expect it's going to be a detailed recommendation. Either, yes, you have sufficient grounds, this is what, you know, they think we might be able to recover, here's the cost of the litigation. Or it might be, no, it's not worth litigating, and here are the legal and economic reasons why. Mm-hmm. And that's the way I'm going to put it to them, but you know, I'm sure that's how they're expecting to respond. So I guess what I'm looking for is an authorization by the council to make that referral.
Well, I think it's time to take action, and I'll make a motion that we pursue.
With the Pfefferly firm?
That Attorney Arneson suggested.
I'll second the motion.
And the name of the firm again is?
Pfefferly.
Go to Pfefferly. At least we know
Pfefferly
where we stand.
Kane. Okay. All right. Motion by Councilmember Yashewski, second by Councilmember Batcher, to pursue a, I guess, how would we say that? What was the wording?
It would be a referral for a review of the recommendation on whether or not we should move forward with litigation.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds good.
That's just how I would have said it.
Yeah, I took the words right out of my mouth. Any further discussion? And that would be with the Pfefferly
Kane
Law Firm.
Yes.
and estimated cost about $1,300, is that right?
More or less.
More or less, yeah. Any more discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. Okay, moving on to new business. Approve or deny the partial pay estimate number 3 to OMG Midwest. The amount of $212,241.85.
I know they haven't been, I know they have this coming, but one of the questions I had, they seem to have stopped working on the project. I know we've had some weather issues. Or did they run away?
I think it's too muddy.
I think, yeah.
They were, in fact, they were putting curb in one day when it was actually raining out.
I drove
by there. I had my windshield wipers on, and they were put, but it just rained and rained. And,
yeah.
And that street that goes down past Gail Wills is, that's like soup. I don't know how you could even get
that
it.
One, yeah.
There's nothing you can do.
Yeah.
I mean, there
the other one dries up pretty quickly now.
Yes.
They have a pretty good layer of
they
gravel.
Got, they got a layer of gravel on top of there.
Yeah.
So that one's sitting where it's where the, I think that must be almost ready to pave.
I think so.
But I the other one's so muddy that I don't, you couldn't move a piece of equipment through there.
Mayor.
Yes.
I did check in with Jason, who's unable to be here tonight, but he did indicate that as of right now, obviously, we need some drier days, but that at this time the contractor is still looking at the substantial completion date of September 1st. Given, you know, the weather conditions, we have had more than usual wet weather recently, but depending on how the next 2 weeks goes, at this time the contractor is still trying to get it open before school starts, and that is their goal.
And I believe school starts on what, around 10th or 11th?
The 11th.
11th, okay.
Barring monsoon season, they should be done.
So we can all stop doing the rain dance.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to make a motion to approve the partial pay estimate number 3 to OMG Midwest Inc. for $212,241.85.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Batchor, second by Councilmember Hyland to approve the payment of OMG Midwest for in the total of $212,241.85. Any more discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. Item number 13, Highland Creek floodplain mapping.
Is again a follow-up to the conversation that the council had in the joint meeting with the Planning Commission regarding the High Island Creek mapping and the impact on flood insurance and the areas that would be designated as flood plain areas for enforcement. And so the at that meeting the council had suggested that we get a estimate from Bolton and Mink. They have provided that so the council can determine if they'd like to move forward and if they would like to distribute the cost. There was some cost discussion or some discussion on dividing the cost or having a cost share with the Quasts, who are in a more timely need of a response than the city would be, but there was some discussion of overall city benefit.
There was a discussion on overall city benefit. Is that something that's required of us to do, Russ, having a mapping of floodplains?
I have a recollection that there's a requirement for insurance purposes to have the floodplain re-examined periodically. And I don't recall, I think it's some kind of a federal regulation, but it's a long period of time. It's either 10 years or 20 years, something like that. I don't recall the last time it was done.
The conversation from that meeting, Councilmember Batchor, was that when this had originally been done, it was a very just kind of a flyover, just this looks like good spots. There wasn't a lot of time and effort and technical aspect done with it, and so one of the concerns that Bolton and Mink had is that you do see this on a lot of old maps that are done, is that because in some respects, some of the area, what's considered floodplain is very far away from the actual creek. Some of it, which is actually has the creek running through it, is not considered floodplain, and so that does impact whether or not those individuals would have access to the floodplain insurance and or are paying for it. And so those individuals who may not be paying for it but are in the floodplain could potentially see some substantial loss based on this previous map.
And the floodplain's based on a 100-year flood.
So if we were to have this redone, this floodplain map, excuse me, what if some of these homes are in the floodplain which were not in the floodplain before?
If they are in the floodplain, they would be required to have that insurance. And so he said that there is the potential that you would see some go in. The Bolton and Mink representative who was here, I think, just looking at it, I think was feeling like there may be more opportunity that properties would come out of the floodplain and therefore would not be required. Or, as he said, you know, the other thing to be considerate of is in the event of a flood, if somebody has, you know, damage and they're well within that floodplain, but they haven't been designated that way, they would not have any insurance to cover that, and that would be completely on their own.
Has there been any other residents that have asked for any kind of map like this recently? In the last...
I don't think so.
couple of years or the last year or something?
Not that we're aware of. Cynthia had indicated that it could potentially open up some additional development areas or make it a little bit easier to develop some of the areas that may be currently considered floodplain that really aren't. So.
I think one of the comments, and correct me if I'm wrong, one of the comments that the representative from Bolton Mink made in regard to the Quest property was if they deal with their property and establish what levels are necessary, that sort of has a ripple effect because there's a bridge close by, or there's going to be another bridge going in on 17 in a few years. So just because they get the height right where they are doesn't mean that the problem ends there.
Well, any fill that they do is going to totally impact the rest of the land surrounding. So,
exactly.
Honestly, what I think you're getting at is what we're going to have to do if we do the survey. We'll have to redo it after they re-elevate that property.
Well, their property would be part of the survey then, or at least their heights would be established as part of that survey.
After. Well, what if they fill that area then?
Their models would... They can
then it would
models.
Change. It would change the whole model.
Right, but they can use their models to project what the elevated would be. Using what the correct elevation should be on their property, they can use their models to figure out how it's going to flow.
So I'm just wondering if we... I'm assuming that they're going to want to get out of the floodplain because I know that property. I used to live right there. It floods. So I'm assuming what they want to do is they want to build up their property so they're not in the floodplain anymore, right? That's my assumption.
It's not their house property, I don't believe, right?
Or well, it's the whole area.
That's behind.
Lot.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah, I think
it's the lot that's
behind. Okay.
On the.
The only thing I. Could
they wanted to build us. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
Contrary to your question, is maybe they want to have a stream rippling in front of their house, going. Some people want that, they're nature lovers, and so then they would accept the being in a floodplain so they could have the stream going by.
Well, regardless, they're going to have, they have a creek in their, on their property, so that that'll happen, but were they not building a house there?
That's what I thought, they were building another structure, and that's, in order to build that, they have to be compliant. So whether we do this or they do this, this has to be done, at least on their property, and they estimated the cost for them alone was $10,000 to $15,000. So we were kind of, everybody was thinking maybe a cost share would be, if we wanted the map done, to maybe cost share with them, since it's going to have to be done anyway because they're going to be doing it.
So who do we cost share with? Do we cost share with
The Quas.
And not the rest of the property owners along right. the creek that own property?
Correct.
Right.
Because, yes. Because the whole reason it's being done in the first place is because of that property. Otherwise it wouldn't be.
But it affects everybody that abuts the creek. So you want the whole town to take that liability, or not liability, but that cost share? What would the cost share look like? I wasn't at the meeting.
Yeah, we didn't talk numbers at all. Besides what it would cost them and the total cost.
And I don't remember, did they say what the total cost to the project was?
If we would get involved in all
yes.
51 properties would be included, wasn't 15,000?
That's just under, 50. Or just under 16.
So it was about 50-50 between, we would almost be splitting with costs, correct? Yeah. Or it was about a little over, close to 30,000 total.
No. 15 is the cost of the entire project.
Oh, the entire deal.
Project.
And if they did it alone, it was 10 to 15.
They would be
10.
Okay. Yeah. So
at 15,000, if we did it, would be 15,770 less what we decided the cost would pay.
Correct. Right.
My concern is for the rest of the citizens that have property there and may not know if it's in the floodplain and something happens and they want to have a claim and then it's and then find out it's in a floodplain.
Right. They've got insurance but they don't have coverage because they're in a floodplain and they didn't know it.
Yeah.
So their household insurance they thought they had isn't going to pay them.
And so I think we need to do this.
But the other side of that coin is if they are in the floodplain and they did and now they're designated at that, their insurance cost is going to be astronomical.
It's going to go higher, without a doubt.
Oh, huge.
Yeah, I've got friends in West Fargo that live on the river. I know what those costs are.
I would like to see if we could maybe take a poll of everybody else that lives on that creek to see how they feel about doing this. Because it's going to definitely affect them one way or another.
Yeah.
Either they're going to be out of the floodplain or they're going to come into it.
Mm-hmm. And there's 51 properties?
51 properties, correct.
If they're in the floodplain, they're going to have to buy insurance for it.
Yes,
it's
they
required.
By law.
Yeah.
And so it needs to be done.
Well, if I live there, this is my thinking. I'm going to gamble, and I'm going to say I've lived there for 30 years, and you know, with the highest that it's ever gotten, it's never flooded me. But you know what? Now that they redid this, I have to pay $5,000 a year for flood insurance on top of all my other insurance. And that was without, I mean, I don't know. I guess I'm trying to. I know last year that there was one house that sold on the creek. And I know that they were concerned about flood coverage, insurance coverage. And I'm thinking that they probably would not have bought the house if they had to pay the flood insurance. So I don't know if that property owner had to pay for a study.
They got
to
reclassify
on their own or not. I mean,
reclassify it on their own.
I would like to check in on that. I mean, if that's the case, and other within the last year have done it on their own. I don't know. I guess I don't feel like
they reclassified the property.
Yes,
and
they
it's
did.
A floodplain.
Yeah.
How much did their insurance go on? That'd be a good question.
Out of the floodplain, I think is what
they reclassified it out of the floodplain.
Oh, out of the floodplain.
So their insurance, I think, was $5,000 just for flood insurance a year.
Really?
But I don't know for sure. I could be totally wrong. I'm just That's what I heard. But, I mean, I would like to maybe table this until I can maybe talk a little bit more and get some more answers.
I thought Tim Olson was going to be here tonight.
No.
No, he wasn't. Okay. Could he?
We could certainly bring
could he
ask
be at,
him back.
I mm-hmm. think we need to bring him back.
Yep.
It's our next meeting.
Well, just looking at the map, that floodplain map, I mean, they got the subway and Quick Stop underwater. And I don't, I know we've got some pretty high.
Well, I know that one rain a couple years ago that the fire department in the city was throwing sandbags up there or whatever.
On the driveway part.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, I'm not saying that this map is wrong or anything like that, but I would just like more information, like when was the last time it's done? How often do these things change? I mean, if the land hasn't changed too much, does this really change?
I think the point maybe was that when it was done, it was not done
correctly
or scientifically. It was done very haphazardly and just... And it was probably back in the 80s, 86, yeah, 80s, mid-80s.
I don't think that we as a city should play with the rules to satisfy our individual needs. The law says if it's in a floodplain, it needs to have the insurance. And we as a city need to find out if it isn't. And these houses are in the floodplain.
I think we run a risk too. I don't have strong feelings one way or the other at this point, but we run a risk sitting here knowing that maybe there are properties that are not in the floodplain that should be, and then they flood. And we haven't done anything. So here you have homeowners then that aren't covered either. Would they come back to us and say, you knew that there was some potential of that property being in the floodplain?
I'm surprised people can even get a loan to buy a home
mm-hmm.
in that area, that a lending institution would borrow them money when they're living that close to a flood area, not knowing if it is in or out, and if it was out or in, of course the lending institution would want that covered by flood insurance. I'm really surprised you could even borrow money to buy something there.
Do we know if there's any homes that flooded in the last few years? We had some high water the last few years.
Well, it'd be June of 14 would be your example.
That was almost 100.
In the house I'm thinking of, they were sandbagging. I don't know if there was water in the basement or not, but...
I think most of the town had water in their basement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, but I'm talking about the
That's an average
different.
Rain this summer.
Yeah.
That's different.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I guess I wouldn't mind getting more information too. I mean, how much insurance does cost? You know, I really don't know. I mean, but.
I'd like to ask Attorney Artisan, what are our obligations on a situation like this, the city's?
Well, I guess one answer could be that if we have a floodplain study on the books, it's not really the city's problem if the study isn't accurate. So I guess issue is raised, what if it turns out that there's a flood and there's some houses that were flooded out that weren't in the official floodplain map? I don't think there'd be a city liability in that case from a legal standpoint. Now, on the other hand, because if you're asking from a moral standpoint, if we have some suspicion that maybe the official floodplain map isn't as accurate as it should be, then maybe it is appropriate for us to have a more accurate map done, or at least have it looked at again, so that if we find out there are some houses that really are in the floodplain that didn't think they were or weren't before, well, it gives them the opportunity then to have the insurance. Now, the insurance is an extra cost, but at least if they're flooded out and they have the insurance, then they have the coverage. If they're flooded out, they don't have flood insurance, they're screwed.
So I have a question for you. Can anybody buy flood insurance, whether you're in the floodplain or not?
That's a good question.
I don't believe so. I think that he had mentioned that you had
to. You have to be.
You have to be designated.
In a flood zone.
Yep. And then because the city follows the floodplain and has a floodplain ordinance, there's a significant discount to those homeowners or property owners who do purchase the insurance versus if we were not following and had the floodplain ordinance in place. But that's not to say a significant discount isn't still expensive, but.
Yeah.
No, I get it.
Yeah.
I'm just curious if you're not in a flood.
I don't believe you are able to.
I think most insurance companies you do have, I know in Laconia we had a sewer backup and they had sewer water in the basement. The insurance company, I think they just had a flat fee of $10,000.
You can up that if you want. You got to ask for it, though.
I think you probably could.
Yep, I did.
Yeah, $10,000 didn't come close.
No, no. But, I mean, I would be under the assumption that if I walked up to insurance man Joe over there and I said, you know, I live on this hill, but I want to buy flood insurance, he'd sell it to me, I'm sure. But that's just my guess. I don't know. And so I would like some more information to answer questions like that.
One other purpose of the floodplain map, of course, is future development. Every time New Orleans floods, of course, the thought goes through the minds of the country, well, you know, maybe they shouldn't have built a city there in the first place. And if you have an accurate floodplain map, that tells us possibly that there are spots in town where we should prevent building from occurring in the future or do our best to discourage it. Although in Arlington, I don't know that that's really that big a factor. Just looking at this, you know, a lot of the area that they have indicated is basically swamp ground and, you know, low-lying area. You know, the proximity of the creek is not what's important. It's the elevations.
Right.
So, and just looking at that, you know, I think there are large areas there that would never be buildable anyway.
And I think one of the points was if you correct the elevation or make it proper on the cross property, that affects everybody else's issues also, because now you're shedding water onto their properties, which may not be at the correct elevation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So.
Well, I mean, that's if you fill the area, but if they were to build because their property is very unique, it does go up gradually or whatever, they'd be definitely closer to other homes if they built higher up on the hill and probably avoid being in the floodplain. But if they started to fill that area,
that's where the problem comes.
But I mean, if you remember, that place was totally full of concrete and ready mix for years and years and years before that all got dug out. So that probably really affected how it looks or whatever too. Maybe even from the 80s. I don't know when they started dumping back there, but I know in the early 90s that was quite the mountain back there of concrete where that property is right now.
Okay, well, let's move along. Is there a motion to table this until next meeting?
I'll make a motion.
Oh, we'll go with Batcher. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Hattelstead, to table the High Island Creek floodplain mapping until the first council meeting in September. Any more discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Continuing disclosure agreement, David Drown Associates.
This is an annual report that the city has to file in regards to all the bonds that have been issued. And so in the past, David Drowns has completed the reporting and they they've submitted a proposal to do this disclosure again. Staff would recommend that we have them do it.
So this is an annual requirement, basically,
correct,
isn't it?
Correct, yep.
Okay. Okay, motion is in order.
I'll make a motion to approve a continuing disclosure agreement with David Drown and Associates.
I'll second it.
Motion by Councilmember Cowell, second by Councilmember Yashevsky to continue the disclosure agreement with David Drown Associates for the annual continuing disclosure services. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Item 15, 2018 budget.
We will need to set a, where we need to notify the county of the budget hearing that is required to take place. And so based on previous years when it's been scheduled, we would be recommending December 4th at 6 o'clock p.m. And that's what goes out with all the tax notifications, so folks know when they can come and hear about the budget and have their opportunity to speak before the council.
Do we need to make a motion?
I would suggest making a motion on that.
I'll make a motion to set the 2018 budget public hearing for December 4th, 2017 at 6 p.m.
Second.
Motion by Councilmember Batchor, second by Councilmember Hattelstead to set the 2018 budget public hearing date and time at December 4th, 2017 at 6 p.m. Any discussion? If not, all say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. And item B, set budget workshop date.
Just thought it might be helpful to set a specific time to do the budget, have a work session. You know, obviously we could always have it as part of a council meeting, but I didn't know if the council would be interested in either having it a different date or before a council meeting or what the preference.
We've usually done it separately, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought we had one set, no?
Mm-mm.
So when we're not going to work through the whole budget at once, or are we going to do the budget in our committees beforehand, before that workshop date, or?
We can certainly do that. You know, I'm not sure what the process has been in the past, but if you'd like, we can do that, or if you want to do the kind of an overview, you know, where we're at, and then go from there, it would be the wishes of the council.
Were you doing our budget again, or?
Nope, Abdo is.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so I'd imagine that the more that we meet with them, the more that it's going to cost us.
Right.
I think it was two, if I remember right.
Yeah, one or two, but.
Two sessions?
Yeah, but I certainly would be willing, you know, if the council wants to meet more during the committee meetings and stuff, I certainly can facilitate that and work with Tom directly. We've done that in the past, so.
It seemed to work good last year's for this administrator to meet with each of the potential committees and see what their wishes were for the upcoming year.
I know we worked really hard trying to bring our budgets in or hit a mark, so I think that would be good.
So there wouldn't be, at this point, a need to set a date then, or would?
I would
still like to get something on the books?
I would still suggest setting one, just because otherwise you start to push up on that September 30th deadline for the preliminary, and then in the event, you know, it's always easier to cancel work sessions than it is to try to put one together, depending on, you know, where the council's comfort level is with the budget.
Can we do Monday, the 18th, before council meeting, or how long do we need, or after the council meeting?
Yeah.
I don't know how long we'll need to do that, or.
So you want to come up with a preliminary number, right? I mean, that's what you, that's what we're, we have to do that by the end of September?
By September 30th, you have to have your initial levy amount, your preliminary levy set. That is the notice that will then go out to all the property owners indicating what their proposed tax would be.
Right, right.
After that point, you have through December to make any adjustments. You cannot go up in the levy. You can go, you can either stay the same or go down. So, you know, I've seen different elected bodies do different things just depending on where their comfort level is. Some, you know, almost use through December as the whole time to work on it. Some, they want it set by September and they want very little tweaking after September. So it's just kind of, you know.
We've always tweaked.
Yeah.
We've always cut it in half pretty much.
Yeah.
Haven't we?
I think we started out at 4 point something last year.
Was it?
Yeah, I think it cut, I think it cut a little bit, yeah.
Then we
cut a little bit.
Yeah.
Trimmed the edges.
Yeah.
Quite a bit, I think.
As you start to get towards the end of the year, you start to get more knowns in your numbers.
Mm-hmm.
You start to figure out what some of the, you know, the reimbursements and some of the tax credits and all that type of stuff, money from the state is, you know, wages, all that type of stuff gets a lot more detailed, so.
Didn't Tom Olinger suggest a percentage we should work on to help build up? 3%
capital.
Sewer water.
Mm-hmm.
Sewer water.
Or what, or do we want to do it on a night that's not our meeting night? If we do it on the 11th or something, that way, I mean, we're doing it, at least we're not we're meeting just with us that first night, right? Is that what you're envisioning?
Right, yes, this would be
preliminary,
a work session, just, yep, to kind of see where it's at, go through it, you know, if there's some additional guidance or suggestions. You know, if you're looking to have it go through committees first and then come to the council as a whole, I'd say you probably want to push it back towards the 30th.
Yeah.
If you're looking to have kind of the council set the overall umbrella and then all the committees work within that, then you want to have that earlier. So.
I think that's probably what we would, what we have done in the past. We didn't, city administrator meet with the committees like in September, October, November, or whatever to fine tune and to cut and that type of thing.
Yeah, but I don't know if we gave an umbrella to start with type thing like she's talking about. I think, you know, a lot of that was kind of, everybody's wish lists was brought to us, and then I think she created the budget.
Right?
And
yeah.
She created the budget,
really?
And then we went back and worked hard in our committees
then
and trimmed.
Committee trimmed.
The only problem is we haven't started yet. And last year she was starting on that already in May and June, meeting with the committees, so. I'm not sure we have time
Do we have to, at a council meeting, adopt that before September 30th?
The preliminary levy amount will have to be adopted prior to or September 30th or before.
Well, then our last council meeting is the 18th of September, unless we have a special council meeting.
Mm-hmm. I would just soon have a special work session, try and come up with a number.
That's what I was going to say.
And then approve that at our regular council meeting.
And let that be the starting number.
Let that be the starting number, and then work with the committee.
Work with the committee, yeah.
After that.
How's September 11th?
That
Monday.
Doesn't work. There's a cemetery meeting that night.
There's an EDA meeting
well,
that
what
night
fits
too.
With your schedule as
what
far
time?
As your
the
days
7
that you'll be here?
Well, I can, I've been kind of switching them around
okay.
to make it work.
So don't look at that initial calendar too
yeah,
closely.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right. I've been adjusting as needed.
Do you have any suggestions? I mean,
no. Right now, I'm tentatively scheduled for September 13th, which is a Wednesday, or September 15th, that Friday. The 18th.
Are those available or they're not available?
Those are the dates that I'm tentatively scheduled to be working in Arlington, but like I said, I can be flexible if there's a different date that works for the council.
Should we try the 15th?
Friday?
Friday.
Oh, no.
The 12th works.
The 13th.
The 12th works really good for me.
12th works good.
Unless the 13th, unless it's at 7 o'clock.
What is the 13th?
Wednesday.
7 o'clock, the third Wednesday.
13th.
Otherwise, the 12th, I'm off all day.
13th at 7 would work for you? Let me do that. No?
I'm going to be out of town.
You're going to be out of town?
Probably till the 17th.
Okay. Woo.
What about the 6th?
If it's before 7 a.m.
The 6th? Why? When are you leaving? The 6th?
7:30 on the 6th.
Until the 17th?
Maybe.
Wow.
Unless I run out of money, and then I'll be home earlier.
Oh, he'll be home earlier.
Oh, boy, oh, boy.
So that's cutting it close, unless we have a special meeting after the fact, like towards the end of the month.
Yeah.
Or if we do the 18th before the council meeting. Yeah, I don't
know.
The only problem is then we're tight, you know, we know that we've got to call the end by a certain time, and I don't want to do that.
Unless we have it after the council meeting on
the 5th?
The 5th, right? Tuesday the 5th. That'll make it for a really early morning for you. Even earlier than 7:30.
I might leave after the council meeting.
Yeah, exactly.
Drive all the way to Gaylord and spend the night.
Is that where you're going?
Hey, they got a water park over there.
I know, they do. It'll be closed though by then.
Oh, yeah.
And they drink in the park.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you sure?
We can have a beer in the park there, can't we, Ben?
We might be stuck with the 5th.
Yeah, I think that'll work for me.
After the regular council meeting.
I mean, I'd rather have you there for it.
For
yeah.
Yeah. That's fine.
Okay, let's do that. We'll do what we can to make that council meeting short.
And September 5th.
Before is the finance committee meeting?
Finance committee at 5:30.
It'll be a long night for us.
City council at 6:30, and hopefully we can start our work set.
We'll be there at 5:30.
7:30 or 8.
We'll be here at 5:30.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Is there a motion, or do we need a motion? Let's do a motion. To set the budget workshop date?
First Tuesday, September 5th, after our council meeting.
Okay. Is there
a second?
Second. Okay. Okay, motion by Councilmember Batchelor, second by Councilmember Cowell to set the workshop, budget workshop for Tuesday, September 5th, immediately after the 6:30 council meeting. Any more discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. All right, let's move into miscellaneous business. Department update, police.
Good evening. First of all, does anybody have any questions about the monthly report? See, that was earlier in the agenda.
No, I do not. Mm-hmm.
All right, then I'd like to introduce to you our new officer, Scott Sandquist.
Scott?
Welcome
to Arlington.
Scott, I would like to swear you in as officer if you want to come forward. We'll take care of that.
Come on up front.
Post pictures of the American flag. that's just patriotic. That's
I'm
going to read that. I'll read with you. So raise your right hand, please. I, Scott Sandquist.
I, Scott Sandquist.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States of America.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States of America.
The Constitution of the State of Minnesota.
The Constitution of the State of Minnesota.
And that I will faithfully and impartially discharge.
And that I will faithfully and impartially discharge.
The duties of the position of police office.
The duties of the position of police office.
For the city of Arlington.
For the city of Arlington.
To the best of my knowledge and ability.
the best of my knowledge and ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Welcome aboard.
We had a couple more signatures on
couple
there.
More signatures. Let's see. Yeah, we need the oldest sign right there.
Both of them?
Yeah. And then Pat.
Oh, okay.
That one?
Mr. Minaber can do his signature.
Oh, there we go. Welcome aboard. Good. Thank you, Pat.
You bet.
You don't have
my
get out of jail free card.
Oh gosh!
I get my address.
One for you.
Yeah, there you go.
Pat can probably help you out there too.
All right. Go ahead with your update if you have additional information.
Well, the additional information is that the background investigation for the chief of police will commence now. Time frame for that. 3 to 4 weeks, assuming all goes well with that, a couple weeks to schedule a psychological and then a physical, make a formal offer, and then whatever time he would need to get his employer. So I think our timeline, where we had said no later than early November, is still on track,
mm-hmm.
and maybe even a little bit earlier than that, assuming all goes well.
Question, we can't piggyback any of those examinations on ones he's had before?
No. Yeah. As far as the psychological posts, 6 months is their recommendation for his finalization.
Okay. Any questions from the council?
Just happy to see us get to this point.
So
yes. Yes.
So,
Scott, did you find a place to live?
Oh, not yet.
Okay, still looking. Still commuting and looking.
Yep. Moving the bowls.
All right.
We can't have you living in the squad car, though.
It's a little bigger now.
I don't think I'd fit.
Yeah. All right. Any questions? Comments? Thanks, Pat.
You bet.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Council member committee updates, anything there? Mr. Yashevsky, any committee updates?
Don't let us down. I do not have any.
Yeah.
All right.
At this time.
What a disappointment.
All right, open discussion. Any discussion?
Yeah, I got a question. I remember we talked about, and the only reason I bring it up because pretty soon we're into September, we discussed the tree situation at Mr. Howie Brinkman's and that
yes.
house of the trees got
yes.
taken down. Nobody got talked to, whatever. We were going to get, I think, an estimate on some trees or the cost to replace them, something a little bigger than a twig.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Did we get anything like that? The only reason I ask is we're getting into planting season.
Right yeah.
On which property?
On the Brinkman property.
On the Brinkman property.
I can get that information.
Yes. Council Member Hyland did visit Conkey Brothers
yep.
up on at Plato, and I think there's some trees that would work. The council really hasn't made a decision where they how far they want to go with if they do want to make any concessions on the comments that the Brinkmans had. Personally, I feel that that we do need to plant some trees for them on their property, not necessarily because the trees were taken down, but because they were taken down without communicating with them.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't remember the costs. Do you...
It
like
was
two?
1.5 inch in diameter to 3 inch for 190 to just over 335.
Okay.
With a 1 year warranty would cost 220 per tree.
And that would be planted.
That would be planted, I believe, yeah. So 220 per tree planted.
That's pretty reasonable.
It is.
That's very reasonable.
But did we not decide that we were gonna do something there?
I thought we did, but I don't remember.
I
don't know if it was ever formal.
I don't think formally we did.
It wasn't formally done?
I don't think so, I think we just all agreed, because at the end of a meeting, kinda like this, I think we all agreed that we should probably do something. And then we were gonna check into.
So we can we put that out as an action item on our next agenda, please?
Yeah.
And I think we could get, well, I talked to Connie over there, and they had a special deal on Amer Maple 3-inch for, I think it was like under $600 in the ground.
Do we want to maybe ask Mr. Brinkman if we have an option of preference of tree?
Well, there is a list that he would have to choose from for the city.
Yeah, I mean, but we.
The city has a list.
Yeah, okay.
Of recommended trees.
But he can choose.
I'd just rather that we talk to him and share that.
Oh, absolutely, work with him.
Just go, here's the tree you're getting.
No, 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 no.
Because we kinda went backwards the first time, I don't wanna see us make that backwards step again.
I agree.
We gotta get this done right.
Yeah, and I think in my conversations, just casual conversations with Councilmember Highland, we decided we really can't do anything until that street is done, the curb is in, the sidewalk is in, then we can, you know, otherwise they're gonna be in the way.
I just brought it up because I didn't wanna see it get kinda forgotten till October, and oh gee, what are we gonna, oh.
And how many trees were there again that were affected?
Two trees.
Was it two? Okay, two trees, alright. And there's nothing to do with boulevard trees that may go in there, these are trees on their property.
Yard property trees, yes.
So I think we should talk to Brinkman before the next meeting and.
Get that list of tree, you know, list of recommended trees, it's somewhere here in the office, I don't.
We see what he would choose.
Sure what they have for trees available, I mean, she just rattled off two or three different trees.
And maybe he could give us a couple choices instead of just saying, oh, I want this one.
See what's on the list and go from there.
We can also give him Conkey's number to see what trees are available off of our list then too. And then he can come back with us and tell us what we want so that we have it for an action point at their next meeting, that would be great.
Otherwise, you know, another suggestion or thought would be that the council could just say, we're gonna provide X dollars and then let them go and choose it and select, you know, based on the list or whatever, but then that way it's just a set amount dependent, you know, we kinda have an idea of what the cost would be. And that
but then we'd be out of it.
Yep, and if they wanted, you know, a nicer tree or like.
Or there were some,
I think in the email it had mentioned how there were some that were like an autumn blaze that were a little bit larger, but then they needed hand watering for a longer period of time. And so that way the homeowner could determine what.
He could upgrade as he wanted.
Exactly.
I think that's a good idea.
That might be a good idea.
That's a good idea. That kinda takes kinda the monkey off our back.
Yeah, then we're done, as soon as we.
We're done with it, we give him a check and.
Yep.
Do as you please.
As soon as the tree is planted, we give him a check.
Yes, reimbursement.
Yeah.
Reimbursement.
Yep.
I think that'd be a great idea.
Okay, that'll be on the agenda for next meeting. Any other open discussion items?
Yeah, I'd like to bring up that Center Point grant. So that was to specifically for the fire department. And I believe Chief Zaski probably spent a lot of time writing that grant. So that was, I think, one point that we missed earlier is recognizing him and the work that he did to get that grant for us. So I'd just like to take time to acknowledge that.
He does work out there.
John works hard at that.
Could we get that word to Kurt Mank also?
Absolutely.
So that he puts that along with the, because I know he's got a picture, so it'll probably get in the paper and might as well. That is. Thank you for that, Councilmember Batcher. Any other open discussion items? Not, motion is in order to adjourn.
Make a motion.
Second.
That's been happening a lot today.
Motion by Councilmember Batcher, second by Councilmember Yashevsky to adjourn the meeting at 8:08. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried.
Aye.